Lightning struck that tall tree right next to my array only months after I installed the system. I was sitting at the window looking at the storm when it happened. And let me tell you, being that close to a lightning strike is something you won't forget. The light was blinding and I could feel the blast of the sound coming through me like an explosion. I was pretty sure it hit the tree. But was my solar system damaged? An event I thought was pretty unlikely was now a clear, imminent threat. In fact, Jonathan from Tiny Shiny Homes just posted a video about how he lost thousands of dollars when lightning struck his system. Welcome back to Projects with Everyday Dave. Today, I'm going to show you step-by-step how to protect your solar investment and your entire house with this simple small device that can be easily installed in just a few minutes. The three big electrical threats I thought of are lightning, solar flares, and EMPs. Since I have a YouTube channel, I decided to do a survey of you, the viewers, to see what you were most concerned about, and here are the results. First, solar flares came in at a measly 16%. I don't think people realize this is a realistic threat. In 1972, a solar flare took down long-distance telephone lines in Illinois, and a flare in 1989 took out power for most of Quebec province. 6 million people lost power for up to 9 hours. A solar storm in 2005 disrupted GPS satellites for 10 minutes. These events are real, and they cause real problems. Historical records show the sun is capable of much larger events than the ones we have experienced since the modern electronic era. Sometimes we forget the sun doesn't always behave itself. Second, EMPs came in at 22%. Maybe that's because it's just more on people's minds. There's a movie coming out about Oppenheimer, and we had that Chinese balloon that made its way across the entire continental US. So I can understand why people might be thinking about that. EMPs purposefully generated in the course of warfare are a known entity. Nuclear weapons can be detonated above the ground to deliberately generate an EMP for the purpose of knocking out electronics and power systems. There are also methods of generating EMPs without a nuclear explosion. But that's just a risk. We don't know that's going to happen. Unlike natural events, we know they're going to happen. It's just a matter of probability. Will it affect me? Lightning, as it turns out, is really your biggest concern at 31%. Maybe that's because some of you are like me and have had a run-in with lightning. According to the National Weather Service, the odds that you'll be struck by lightning in the US during your entire lifetime is only 1 in 15,300. And that's probably a statistic that you've heard before, and so you haven't been that worried about it. Finally, that's a chance we all have to take, but the odds for your home are not as good. And your home doesn't have the ability to hide from lightning. For homes, the number is actually 1 in 200 in the US. In fact, 700,000 homes in just the United States get struck by lightning each year. That makes lightning our biggest threat by far. Finally, 31% of you just aren't concerned about it. And that's the bucket I was in until I watched lightning strike just feet away from my array. Now, if I group together all three big risk events, 69% of my viewers are concerned about at least one of these. What I want is a way to protect my system against all known power surge threats. So I did some research on the topic, and there are actually a number of companies offering home protection from lightning, and there are a few companies offering protection for solar systems. For the most part, they consist of a device like this that senses voltage spikes and then shunts it to ground in milliseconds before it can damage electronic devices. But it really comes down to one question. Do they work? I had three main criteria for my search. One, it had to protect against lightning, solar flares, EMPs, and general power surges. Two, it has to protect both my solar equipment and the equipment in my house. Three, I need some kind of proof that it'll actually work, since this isn't something I can test myself. And usually, I test everything myself. The company I settled on that could meet all of those criteria makes this device, and they are called EMP Shield. Now, I can't test this and prove that it works, so I suggest you do your own research. I'll link to their certification information in the description below, and you can read it all for yourself and make sure that you're fully convinced that this device is actually going to work for you and your situation. What gives me confidence that this device is going to work is the extensive certification that they've gone through. It's certified by the government and used in military devices and has gone through all kinds of independent testing. I talked to the manufacturer and asked them how this is actually performing in the real world. And after all that investigation, even though I can't be 100% sure, I'm reasonably confident that this is going to work. This device protects against all types of power surges, and they are so confident in their product, it comes with a $25,000 insurance policy to cover your equipment in the unlikely event that something is damaged by a lightning strike. As it turns out, this level of confidence in insurance comes at a pretty high price. Most of these units are a little under $400. I reached out to EMP Shield to see if they were willing to support my install, which they were happy to do. as well as give you, the viewer, a $50 discount per unit if you want to purchase one. All you have to do is use the link and the code in the description below. There are some cheaper solutions, one of which I'm going to use in today's install, and I'll list some other options on my website for your reference. Now, there's some very important things to know when you're installing these. If you don't install them correctly, they won't work, and you have to use the right device for the right thing that you're trying to protect. So let's get started with the install. Unfortunately, lightning is a tricky thing, and protecting your solar system requires more than just one device. You've probably seen SPDs, surge protection devices, like this one. They're about $12 each and are commonly used in solar systems to protect each PV input. And I have some on my system. Now, if you watched Jonathan's video, you know that these devices were not sufficient to protect his equipment. However, I have multiple inverters, SunGold inverter, SolarEdge inverter, I'm gonna be adding some Victron inverters, and it's pretty expensive to add enough of these devices to cover every one of those PV inputs. Hopefully, you don't have such a complex system. And part of that's because I'm always testing new inverters. So for the sake of the budget, I'm going to use these $12 SPDs to cover my PV inputs because I have so many of them. But later when I expand and add my Victron solar charge controller, I'll go ahead and add an EMP to protect that device. My SolarEdge inverter has some built-in lightning protection, so I'm just trying to balance things at the moment. So strategically, my first application will be to protect the most expensive equipment with the least number of devices. So I'll be installing these two units today. My first device will be for the home. It will protect the entire home electrical system and all of the appliances that are plugged in throughout the home. The second device I will use to protect my 48-volt battery backup system. It makes sense to spend a few hundred dollars to protect over $6,000 in equipment. So let's get these two installed. The installation for the home is very simple. There are four wires. The green goes to ground, the white goes to neutral, and then the black and red go to line one and line two. Even though the device is completely filled with a potting material, and that makes it totally waterproof, you still need to use a piece of conduit to connect this to the load center. That protects these THHN wires and allows you to meet code. Most load centers will have a main breaker that you can shut off, and it's usually located at the top. That will disconnect power for the entire panel. My breaker is located out at the meter, so I have to run out there to shut it off. Once the power is off, I can remove the panel and make sure that there is no power on the lines before I get started. A couple millivolts, if anything at all, so we're good to go. Even though there's no power to my main panel, my emergency circuits are still on. That's how come I can still get lights, because my Victron backup system is running all of those when the power is out to the main system. Now we want to catch both legs, and you can see the bus bar set up to have every other breaker on a leg. So this breaker, this row of breakers will be on leg one, then this row of breakers will be on leg two, and this row of breakers will be back to leg one. So that's why we gotta have two breakers stacked on top of each other to catch both legs. I'm gonna mount the unit right under this panel, and I'll put a little extension block on here with some pocket screws to mount it to, and knock out this one knockout here, and then we'll make sure the wires reach where we need to go. To attach this, there's a couple of components that you'll need to provide. A short piece of 3/4 inch to go from the box to an adapter, and a 3/4 inch threaded adapter to go into the load center. There, I can do a dry fit, make sure it works, and then I'll apply the adhesive, and we'll be good to go. My hole punched out, I can feed the wires through. Now, first we'll route the ground wire and I'll connect it to the ground bus. And the instructions say not to have any more length than necessary, which goes against my typical keep a little extra service loop wherever you can. So in this case, we'll go ahead and follow the instructions and keep it short. These are stranded wires, so I like to use ferrules. With the ground wire tightly connected, I can do the exact same process for the neutral. The neutral connects to the neutral bus bar, and I also added a ferrule to that one just for good measure. You don't have to add ferrules, but I like to do it for stranded wire. It just gives a little bit better connection. The two hot legs just reach the breaker the way they are, so I don't need to adjust the length at all. Just strip them and add a ferrule. The black and red wires can go to the two breakers we installed earlier. For an AC connection, it doesn't matter which goes to line one and which goes to line two. You can connect these to existing breakers as long as it's one right above the other. I'm using a separate breaker because I have the space for it, and I don't like to share lugs if I don't have to. Make sure the lug is tight and give it a tug to make sure it won't come out. These stranded wires don't stay in place very well, so I'm just gonna throw a little zip tie in there to make sure everything stays nice and neat. All right, everything's hooked up. The EMP shield is securely mounted below the panel. The wires are running through a conduit, and that is secured on the other side. The ground wire comes out and connects to the ground bus. The neutral wire comes out and it goes up and connects to the neutral bus. And then the two hots, the black and the red, make their way up and connect to a breaker, one right above the other, to make sure we're catching both lines. And right now those are off, but we'll close up the panel and then we can turn everything back on and make sure it works. Now I can turn the power back on. All right. All right, let's turn the breakers on. Turned one on, you can see line one lit up. Turn the other one on. And line two is lit up. Now those are blinking on the screen, but they're just straight lit up. All right, that was pretty simple. Everything's wired up, everything's turned on, the lights are on, I know it's working, and now my entire house and all of my appliances are protected. Next, I need to protect the battery, so let's do that one. Now I have a 48 volt nominal battery pack, so I'll use the 48 volt unit to protect my battery pack. I'm just gonna find a nice spot on my panel to mount it here, then I can route the plus and minus to the main terminals of the plus and minus for the battery. The ground wire I'll route over to one of the inverter chassis grounds, and that will sufficiently ground it out. I opened up the panel for my Victron here, and there's this nice little chassis ground lug that I can utilize. And I have a box of lug fittings with shrink tube on them that we can crimp to it, and that'll allow us to attach to this post. And I'll use the one with the larger hole in it to attach to the main lugs for the battery terminals. So that's how we'll secure those. I turned the battery bank off to prevent any arcs or unexpected shorts, especially since I'm not working with insulated tools. I'm laying out a clean path to the lug, then shortening the wire to the appropriate length. The black goes to minus and the red to plus. I'm using the same crimped ring connectors on all three wires. They have an adhesive in them that completely seals the joint. To make sure I maintain the appropriate contact surface for the main lug, I'm putting the smaller EMP shield terminal on the back side. It's a little tricky, but it works out pretty well. The positive terminal bolt needs to be a little bit longer. I stacked an extra nut on the top to secure the positive sensor for the Victron shunt, but it'll have to do for now. All right, that was super quick and easy. The EMP shield is on, and I don't know if you can see or not, but the light is lit up. That means everything is connected properly. The ground connected to the ground lug on the case ground for the inverter, and then the plus and minus are connected to plus and minus for the 48 volt battery pack. So everything's good to go. Now I can close it all up. Now, later I'm gonna add some EMP shields up right next to my inverters, but for now I'm gonna put these surge protection devices right here at the array. And I'll leave them there even when I add the other ones at the inverter, so I have some protection at both places. Before I get started, I want to make sure that there is no power in the box, because I was looking at the meter this morning and my array was putting out 500 volts, and I'd rather not get hit by 500 volts. So not only will I disconnect the breaker here in the box, but I want to make sure even those lugs don't have power on them. And I can achieve that by disconnecting the MC4 connector at the solar panel. So let's go ahead and do that. All right, there we go. I'm not interested in getting hit by 500 volts. Now I can double check with the meter, and it's showing a few millivolts, so basically nothing. Nothing. All right. One of my favorite ways to set these things up is to use these Dinkel DinRail terminal connectors. It's just a really clean way to organize things. And I can easily connect these two together with these little jumpers. So I already have one surge protector hooked up for this circuit, and I'm gonna add one for this circuit. Now, I was talking to Clayton at International Connector. I was telling him some of the issues I had. One of them was these breakers slide around a bit, and I don't like that. And he said, well, we've got these little stoppers you can put on there. They snap on and I can run the screw in and it will secure both sides of that. In fact, I added a couple here to secure this lower block, and I'm gonna use these to secure this whole top band when I'm ready. The other thing he said was, instead of putting these ground lugs on there, I can just use these ground terminal blocks. And they actually have a connection from the lugs all the way to the DIN rail itself. And they make a ground connection without having to run extra wires. So instead of running a wire all the way over here to the ground lug, I can just throw a couple of these guys right on the rail. So I have this guy basically where I want him already. Maybe I'll move it over just a little bit. So I can put one of these stoppers on here. And that'll set this side. There we go. Then I'm gonna put another set in here, put in my breaker and another surge protector. And then I'll put in two ground lugs at the end that I can just connect right over to. Wow, those are tight. I don't think I'll need a stopper on the other side. These ground lugs are super tight. Yeah, there we go. Okay. Now I'm all set up to add another circuit. So the way this works, I have my PV lines coming in, plus and minus from the array through my breaker. And then the output of that goes to this terminal block and from the terminal block to the house. Now, the reason I have two inputs to the terminal block is one goes to the house and the other one jumps over and goes to the surge protector. So this block is tied together with this little jumper. So I can have one output and two inputs here. And that way the surge protector can be connected to the plus and the minus. And then if there's a problem, it will shunt those two voltages to ground at the ground bus or ground at the terminal block. With these DIN rail ground lugs, I don't need the bus bar anymore. I can just cleanly run it right over to the lugs. Now both surge protectors can just hop right over to the ground lugs and they'll be connected directly through the DIN rail right to the chassis. Now I can just confirm the continuity. All right. Now I'm going to turn these two blocks into a bus bar by adding this little jumper, and these two blocks into a bus bar. There we go. Now I can connect black to the breaker, service loop in there, and black to the negative side of the surge protector. Now, another way to do this would be to go directly from the negative of the surge protector to the negative of the breaker, but then I'd have two conductors under one lug, and that's a good opportunity for having a failed connection. This way, each lug has one connector all the way across. I get my connections that I need through my jumpers. The ground is connected through the DIN rail. I mean, it's just nice, clean, secure way to do it. All right, now I have a breaker and a surge protector for string 3 and a breaker and a surge protector for a future string 4, which hasn't been run yet. Everything's grounded and good to go. Now that my work in the panel is done, I can go ahead and reconnect my MC4 connector. 480 volts. So I can turn my breaker back on, close up my service panel. Now I can turn the inverter back on and we're all done. Not too hard. I feel much better now. I've got my EMP shields installed. It's like trying to get your roof on before it rains. Now I'm ready for a lightning strike, and if one comes, I'll be sure and let you know how it performs. I'm working on an expansion to my Victron system to add a solar charge controller, and I'll also add an EMP shield when I install that, so be sure and stick around for that information. If you didn't see the upgrade to my split phase install, I'll link to it right here, so be sure and check that out. I've been adding lots more information to my website, projectswithdave.com, to try and support you with all of your installs. I have lots of great, interesting content coming up, so be sure and stick around, and I'll see you next time.